So, and now today they go on to Eidos, essence, to all these things that you hear, technical terms used about the phenological reduction, eidetic reduction, transcendental reduction, the transcendental ego. And that's how far we'll get today, I guess. So that next time we will go on to subjectivity, intersubjectivity, objectivity, empathy, normativity, and ethics. So these are the three main themes that we'll talk about in Husserl as a kind of general philosophy. And then in the fourth lecture, since very many of you are following Øystein's course, we go there into Husserl's philosophy of mathematics, his relation to Gödel and Hermann Weyl and some others. And then we will, after that, take up other more specialized topics that some of you might be interested in. So here we have the people who he was working with. And some of you mentioned psychology, two of you actually. Freud, who was important in psychology, was a fellow student of Husserl and de Brentano. And that's his life and work. Here you had the idea of perception. The traditional view is that perception is reception. And then this picture shows that it can't be just reception, because you can see it as a duck and as a rabbit. And it's the same thing that reaches our sensory organs all the time. So there must be something else beside what reaches our sensory organs that is crucial for perception. And then we had the horizon, the fact that we have a lot more anticipations when we experience things, also, for example, when we perceive things, than those that we are aware of. And I mention William James because he, in the 1890s, seems to have been the first one to really take up that idea that there's so much going on subconsciously, which are important for how we experience things. And he uses the word fringes for that, which uses the word horizon. But that's a point where Husserl quite clearly got it from James, because I did mention that Husserl was tempted to go back to mathematics after he had read William James, because he thought that James, in his Principles of Psychology, had done exactly what Husserl wanted to do in philosophy. But then he thought more about it, and he did a lot more things that all relate in some ways to these early ideas. And then you had the intentionality, all these anticipations. And for those who have read Gadamer, Gadamer was a student of Heidegger, and Gadamer gives credit to Heidegger for all these ideas. But actually, what is so central in his interpretation is that we are approaching every text, every work of art and so on, with a lot of anticipations. And Gadamer wanting to create a little bit of interest in his work, decided to call these anticipation prejudices, Vorurteile in German, and it has the same overtones as prejudice. We don't want to have prejudices when we approach things. And Gadamer says, but you always have prejudices, you always have these anticipations when you come to things. So don't imagine that you can just be completely neutral and just accept what comes. Every interpretation, every conception of what is going on, both in perception and in communication by words or pictures, is already very, very strongly colored by what you bring to it. So that's the basic idea in what is sometimes called new hermeneutics, and which is then associated with Gadamer. And Gadamer found these ideas in Heidegger, but of course Heidegger took them over from Husserl. So that, and in fact in Husserl they are much more worked out in detail. So those of you who are interested in Heidegger should definitely study Husserl, because a good deal of the key ideas there in Heidegger are worked out with great detail, a good deal of argumentation in Husserl. And that holds for these basic ideas that Gadamer used in hermeneutics. Hermeneutics is simply the theory of how to interpret. Also, and then I mentioned that these anticipations, in fact the word anticipation has too much to do with what comes. In fact, in English it's spelled T with an I, but it should be anticipation, because it has, ante means before, and it has to do, it comes before. It's not that you're against, but you're beforehand having these views, and you're anticipating what is coming. But you're not only anticipating what the future will be like, but you're also anticipating a lot of features in the present, and you're anticipating that if you knew more about the past, you would find, for example, I mentioned a big tree as an example, that big tree was probably there yesterday as well, although it might be a tiny little bit smaller as we go further back in its history. So they, what we call anticipations, are really things that have to do both with the present, with the future, and with the past. And then we'll see how values come in. We anticipate that certain things have value. We anticipate that certain things are sweet, others are sour, and also that certain things hurt, others do not hurt. And these are important, of course, for ethics. When we do things, some of the things we do might hurt, others might experience as very nice things. And then we also mentioned that it's important for Husserl that we are actually experiencing the objects themselves. There's nothing in between. But there are a lot of anticipations involved, but there's not first sense data or surfaces and then an inference to there being an object. So that Descartes' idea that he looks out the windows and sees these bodies moving around and he wonders, how can I get from the idea of a body to the idea of a human mind? And that's an inference that he struggled with a lot. But for Husserl, you are actually experiencing people and not bodies. And it will come to it. Then we have these anticipations in connection with perception. And the idea with these triangles is that some structures are simply incompatible with what happens. When we are perceiving, something goes on at our sensory surfaces, eyes, ears, touch, and so on. So when you have these things going on at the sensory surfaces, they are all compatible with lots of ways of structuring the world, Husserl says, but there are certain ways of structuring it with which it's not compatible. So that the important thing is that, you remember the picture from Aristotle, there seems to be no options. The object is imposing upon itself upon us, and we just accept it. With Husserl, there are many different options. So what we experience is underdetermined by the what goes on at our sensory surfaces. But still, what goes on at our sensory surfaces is really important for perception, because there are lots of ways of construing the external world that will simply not be compatible with what we are experiencing. And this, by the way, comes back in Sartre. We are not going to go into Sartre here, but this is one of my many points of similarity. And Sartre studied Husserl quite carefully, and especially the early work by Sartre, when he was more careful, is very close to Husserl. The later works by Sartre are getting very, very big and heavy, and he is very often inspired by Husserl. That he had great troubles going back and crossing out something that he had done. When I write, I try to write and find out I wasn't quite good at the beginning and I had to rewrite. With Sartre, what happens is that he writes and then gradually changes his view as it goes on. But when he changes his view, he doesn't go back to the beginning and change the whole thing. But you can see how his view is changing, so that towards the end of the work, he often says things that are simply contradicting what he said in the beginning, but he doesn't seem to have had the patience to really go back and rewrite the whole thing. He did it with his literary work. There he polishes and puts a lot of work into the text, and they are relatively short, but the philosophical writings are big, big volumes, and often a little bit repetitive, and also with the view changing as you go on. But in any case, so he discusses the same thing and calls this the coefficient of adversity. So what happens at our sensory surfaces is a kind of coefficient of adversity, and we have to experience ourselves as being in a certain kind of surrounding that accounts for this adversity. And here we have the kind of factors that go into the structuring, and it's partly induction. Husserl was rather impressed by Mill, who talks about induction as being a basis for a good deal of other anticipations. So that when I anticipate, it's very much based on past experience. One example that I could give you is that if you have a baby crawling around on a carpet in your home, then babies get pretty early accustomed to rings. That's the kind of toy you often give a small baby. And then if you have been careless and left a pair of scissors partly under the carpet, but so that one handle which looks just like a ring and extrudes, the baby has no experience with scissors, but with rings, and here the baby sees what the baby anticipates to be part of a ring and draws it out, and you get the whole scissor out. The baby will probably be a little disturbed, and you certainly as parents would get very disturbed. And Husserl calls this a kind of explosion that takes place. The pattern of anticipations simply collapses. You get something completely new. And next time the baby sees something like that, the baby will be a little uncertain, vacillate between anticipating things having to do with scissors and anticipating things having to do with rings. So that's how we got all these anticipations. But in these also practical usefulness come in. And since so many of you have worked on Heidegger, one example that Heidegger is famous for is the example of the hammer. And it's often used to contrast Heidegger and Husserl. One often says that Husserl was very interested in the anticipations it had to do with what the world is like, but that Heidegger came in with something new in that he also brought in practical activity, so that our practical activity will also contribute to our structuring the world around us. And Husserl uses the hammer example for which Heidegger became famous. Husserl says that the hammer is something that plays a role in our practical activity, and our practical activity anticipations are also part of this thing. So the practical usefulness comes in, values come in, and also one thing which Merleau-Ponty points out is that we have a lot of bodily settings that are also shaped by past experience and help us to anticipate future experience. I don't remember whether a week ago I mentioned running on a trail. That's an example that I think might help. If you are spending every morning jogging on a trail, soft, nice trail in the forest, and then someday somebody has put concrete on it, but put needles and so on over, so you can see that there's a difference. Still, when you run across there, you sense that there is a difference. Your steps don't fit the way they usually. So you may notice that there's something recalcitrant in your experience there. And that is because you are anticipating, not just by thinking about things alike and having what we would normally call perception of it, but your bodily movements are part of how you anticipate. And when you run on that trail, your bodily movements are quite important for the habitualities that you have formed in those movements. And now those make you aware that something strange is happening. And that happens often in our lives, that we notice there is something strange here. Sartre often uses that, there's something strange. And that's because we encounter something that where our anticipations are shaped by earlier experience. We have not thought about it, anything like that. And this is a very important topic in also the bodily settings. And that, again, something that comes back in Heidegger. So, but Heidegger tends to get credit for a lot of things that really are worked out more in detail in Husserl. And but Merleau-Ponty worked this out even more in detail than Husserl did. And the manuscripts where Husserl writes a lot about this were made available to Merleau-Ponty in 1939 in Leuven, in Belgium. And Merleau-Ponty is always very explicit and expresses his indebtedness. He says he's very, very grateful that he was permitted to read his manuscript by Husserl. But unfortunately, Heidegger really doesn't express any kind of gratitude, although he knew all these manuscripts by Husserl because he was Husserl's assistant. You'll notice that I don't like Heidegger much as a person. I think that his philosophy is fine, and lots of nice things in his philosophy, but most of them I recognize from Husserl, and I know that in Husserl's work, a good deal of those things are worked out with much more care and much more justification or argument supporting the view. I don't know, did I mention a week ago Husserl's comments on Heidegger's Sein und Zeit? Did I?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, but at least they're close in their views, but you'll find that almost every point that Heidegger makes, you can find a similar point in Husserl, but supported with more arguments. And also John Perry, a colleague at Stanford, he has independently of Husserl talked about the person, like body, being a certain kind, a zero point in space, so that all my perception and so on and lots of other things are connected in a very special way to my body and to my location in space, which he calls the zero point in space. And that's quite important for example, understanding indexicals and various other features in language. And then I talked about the iceberg, the morning star, evening star example. And now we get to a parallel between Husserl and Frege. Because Brentano, who was Husserl's teacher, he was very interested in the notion of intentionality, which he thought that he could find already in Aristotle. And I think he's right. He was an Aristotle expert. And Thomas Aquinas was also one of the persons he studied very carefully. And he said that what characterizes human consciousness is that we are always conscious of something. So there's always a kind of directedness to an object. And then he says that for every act, an act would simply be not always just an action which involves bodily movement, but it could be an act of thinking. There's something that takes place over a certain period of time. And what characterizes it is that it's directed to an object. That directedness of consciousness is what Brentano focused on, and that's also what all of his students focused on. So they were very impressed by that idea, and they saw, on the other hand, that there are problems in Brentano because he said that there will always be an object. And he gave lots of examples. For example, when I see something, there's an object that I see. When I talk to somebody, there's an object, a person to my talking, and so on. So there's always this directedness. And then his students, that's what all good students should do, they came up with problems. They said, but what about this? For example, there was a period when mathematicians tried to calculate what is the largest prime number. And they didn't find it. And we now know there is no largest prime number. But what was the object of the search? Well, the object was to find the largest prime number. But since there is no such object, this will be an act that has no object. And likewise, when I hallucinate, for example, if I hallucinate a sword hanging there, my hallucination is very much like perception, but there is no object. So what should we do if there is no object? Brentano had originally not seen the problem, but then, of course, when the students brought it up, he had to think about it. And he kept on thinking about that problem until he died in 1918. And there were his various students also proposed ways of dealing with it. Brentano's attempt was to say that objects exist in the act, so that if there is no object properly, then there is still an object, but it is part of the act and it's not out there. But of course, when I hallucinate, I experience an object as being out there. And Brentano would say, well, it's part of the act. But things get rather messy, and his students were pretty good at bringing up problems. So that's one of his students, named Mai Nong. He said, I have a good solution. There are two kinds of objects. There are those that exist and those that don't. So normally in perception, the object I experience is existing object. But when I hallucinate, then my object is a non-existing one. So there is always an object, so he could agree with his teacher, always an object, but there are two kinds, those that exist and those that don't. Brentano himself, although this was intended to be a solution for him, thought that that's not a good solution. And then there were other, there was a person named Twardowski, who went on to Poland and was very important for the development of philosophy and also of logic in Poland. And he had an other variant of Magnon's view, also having to do with the existence not being, existence is a kind of property that some things have and other things don't. But Brentano himself said, no, that doesn't work. Existence is not a property of that kind. But then what Husserl said is that, well, an act always has a structure. It has a structure as if of such an object. But the fact that the act has that kind of structure, that you have all these anticipations, doesn't guarantee that there is an object there, so that there will be objectless acts. What is crucial to there being an act is that there is some structuring going on. And he introduced this idea, says the act, and then the structuring is called the noema, and then you have the object. And that's what we are going to talk about now very soon. But I should mention that you know similar ideas, for example, from Frege. Frege said that you have names. Names refer to objects, and they do it by having a certain meaning. So that previous picture, morning star, that's an example from Frege. The morning star, the evening star, those things. It's the same star, but we experience it in different ways. And it took a while before astronomers in the old Babylonian found out that it's the same one celestial object, just experienced from two different perspectives. And that was Frege important in order to explain identity. Frege proposed that in an article in 1892 on Sense and Reference, and that article was the end of a long struggle he had, because he struggled with that same idea and found finally that this was a way of looking at it. So you have this trichotomy, name meaning object. But Bolzano, this philosopher whom I think I did mention, he had that exactly same idea 60 years earlier. So he And he worked it out much in detail. And you actually have similar ideas even in the Stoics and so on. It's a fairly natural idea. And I wrote an article once, it was back in the 70s, where I compare Husserl's phenomenology to, at this point in Husserl, with Frege. This was a lecture I gave to people who are very familiar with Frege, but hadn't heard about Husserl, and then I wanted to explain Husserl so that they could more easily understand what Husserl had done and where his contributions went beyond Frege's. So that's why I compared Frege and Husserl, and that's why this interpretation that I'm now giving is sometimes called the Fregean approach to Husserl. And there are many people who work on Husserl who object to it, because they say it's not possible that the great Husserl could be so close to an analytic philosopher like Frege. I think we reject all these labels. I think we should always study the philosopher for what that philosopher is, look very carefully at what he's saying, and not use labels. I think labels are really introduced partly just to create polemics. And they tend to close people's mind, because there's so much published that you don't have time to read it all. And then I feel very unhappy that there's so much I want to know about which I don't know about. But it could be a comfort if you could put a label on it, and that label is so negative that you say that's not a word at all reading, so I say my not a word. And these kind of labels have been used a lot in philosophy, unfortunately. Positivism is such a label, you know, those philosophers are positivists, so why should you care, waste your time reading those? And then at this time analytic philosophy was contrasted with continental philosophy. I think that that again closes one's mind. Analytic philosophers said, well, those continentals are not worth reading, and many people on the continent said, well, that's analytic philosophy, that has nothing to do with the real problems. It's just talking about words and things like that. But in any case, I think that it's good to get rid of those labels, and also in political purposes, I think a lot of political campaigns, and very much violence in the world, takes place because one introduces these labels, and just you don't explain clearly what is meant by the label, but you just group people under that label, and if you can make the label sound very negative, like Muslim or something like that, then you have achieved your goal. So I think philosophers should know better and not go into that kind of debates at all. But in any case, I think that there is a structural parallel here between Frege and Bolzano on one side, Husserl on the other. And you should also know that Husserl was thought very, very highly of Bolzano. Bolzano is, I mentioned Wernberg, who wrote this history of philosophy, where Bolzano was the first major philosopher of the 20th century, born in 1781. So in any case, now that's how far we got last time, and now we'll look more closely at this notion of an act, because acts are much more complicated than people are aware of. So when I compare Husserl to Frege, that's only a first step, because for both of them the notion of sin or sense meaning is important. The noema has the sole role as meaning. And when Frege talked about the reference or a name, he was very simple. He said, a name has a meaning. And thanks to that meaning, that name attaches to that object. That object satisfies the name. And there are some names which have such a meaning that there has to be only one object satisfying it, and they would be the proper names. But then you have words like green, which has an extension consisting of all the green objects. And building, all buildings are in that extension, but some proper names, they have a meaning that applies to only one object. And sometimes you have words which don't fit anything. A word with a meaning, like largest prime number, an expression, which fits no object. So Frege was able to account both for how we can have words, and if you transfer it to internal acts, which have a meaning but don't have an object. And also the notion of identity, which have been much in clarity about identity, that's very straightforward. You have two expressions that have different meanings but the same object. And it's when you discover that those two different meanings actually fit the same object that you can assert through identity. So that was Frege's view, and now Husserl introduces the notion of noema. He didn't do it until 1911. They come out first in the ideas in 1913. He doesn't use the word in earlier writings, but his early writings are pointing towards this notion. And once he had introduced the notion, the word noema, he says that without understanding the word noema, you can't really understand phenomenology. And then the others who have criticized my view on the noema as this kind of thing that plays a similar role as meaning in Frege, they say that the notion of noema is nothing central in Husserl. but they haven't read Husserl, because Husserl says that without understanding the Ima, you don't really understand phenomenology. And it comes back again and again and again in his writings, a very frequently occurring word. And the point is that the Noema, which plays the same role as sense, meaning, or Sinn in Frege, is much more complicated than Frege. Because when we hear this arrow indicates Husserl's view on acts, here you have an act that has a certain directness towards an object out there. But how can it have that directness? Well, for Frege, it has it because it simply consists of a lot of features, properties, that the object has. So if there is one and only one object that has those properties, then that's the object of the act. Frege admitted that there could be acts without an object. You have properties that don't fit any object. But Husserl now introduces a good deal more notions that we need really in order to appreciate what he is doing. So this arrow here is one that you should pay close attention to, because it really tells the structure. That arrow tells you a lot about Husserl's phenomenology, the basic structure of Husserl's phenomenology. First, we start out with an act. That's where Husserl took over from Brentano. All of Brentano's students focused on act. That was the very central notion in Brentano. Brentano himself focused on it. So what is an act? Well, it is something that is temporal. It starts at a certain time, ends at a certain time. And in the act, there are two temporal elements here. On that side, we have the temporal elements in the act. They are the hyle and the noesis, and now I'll explain those two notions. The hyle are experiences that we undergo when our sensory organs are affected. So when I touch something, when I open my eyes, when I taste something with my tongue, smell something with my nose, then I experience hyle. Very many later philosophers have talked about sense data, both earlier and later. Husserl avoided that. There are no objects that constitutes my smell. I can smell an object, but a smell is an experience, not an object. So these things are experiences, and they have a temporal start at a certain time and end at a certain time. And there's also something else that is temporal, and that is what he calls the noesis. And that, he uses these words, noesis, noema, and so on, because he gradually understood that his way of using many words was really different from how other people had used them, and that people misunderstood him. And although Husserl was so interested in intersubjectivity and so on that we're getting to, he himself understood that he was not very good at understanding these other philosophers. So that very often when he wanted to write something on Descartes, or mention Descartes, he asked some of his students whom he knew had read Descartes a lot, and asked them, is that right? Is that the way Descartes thought? So that he was always a little bit uncertain about the words. And in the beginning, he used these words, thinking that he meant what other people had used them meant, but discovered that that was not the case. Of course, one reason for it is that people, even philosophers, would often use the words differently. The meaning of the words we use depends very much on the whole structure within which we use them. And therefore, Husserl, in 1907, is very enthusiastic. He has discovered that a true philosopher must be an idealist. So his writings from then on are called idealist writings. One of you worked on Kant, for example. Kant is a typical idealist. And you had Fichte and Hegel and so on, typical idealist philosopher. And Husserl said, I'm like them. I'm an idealist. And then as he developed his philosophy, people then criticized his view and said, well, you don't really think that things exist and so on outside the mind and so on. And gradually understood that the word idealism doesn't fit what he was doing. And there is a letter that he wrote in 1936, 2 years before he died, where he says that people call me an idealist, but nobody could be more of a realist than I am, and I never use the word idealist anymore. So he had understood that his use of the word idealism was really misleading. He was not an idealist in the sense of the big idealists, but there is something very interesting in his philosophy which shows that he's not, he says that he's a realist, but you have some philosophers who are what we call naive realists. They just accept that this is what the world is like. Husserl has a kind of realism that is different from anybody else. And there's a philosopher at Harvard, Hilary Putnam, who developed a view which is rather similar to Husserl's view. On Putnam calls it internal realism. And that is that Putnam himself, his view changed gradually. But I often talked to Putnam when I was at Harvard and explained Husserl to him and said, Putnam had this idea before he heard about Husserl. But I said that your view that you call internal realism is really very similar to that of Husserl. And I think for this reason, when Husserl used the word idealism, it's not like the most more common forms of idealism, but it's not a realism either. Husserl saw that he was not a normal realist, but then he thought, then I'm an idealist, but that doesn't really fit very well. So gradually he simply avoided using the words that philosophers had tended to use. So that these are, you could call technical terms, these are words that you don't find in other philosophers. You do find them historically in Greece and how they were used, but that's not what was in his mind. He wanted to express his own view in this way. So what he calls noesis is the kind of experiences that we undergo, then we are structuring the world, structuring our experience. So it's a kind of structuring activity. And you talked about that structuring, that we anticipate things and so on. Those anticipations clearly are processes taking place in our minds. So that there are two kinds of processes taking place in our minds. One is Hyle and one is noesis. Hyle provides the boundary conditions and the noesis provides the final decision, although it's not a decision you officially make, it just the noesis fixes the particular structuring that you had in mind. So if you think back at that tree, all these triangles that I had, then the Hyle excludes some possible structurings. I said that you can't see a locomotive over there, but some kinds of structuring would be compatible, so that the noesis is simply the structuring activity. I think if you should define it in an understandable way, structuring activity would be a good word, because it's an activity and it structures our experience. And the Hyle would be those experiences we have that impose constraints on how we can structure our surroundings. Just ask, but this is just a short attempt to explain those two basic notions. And those are all temporal notions. The Hyle begins when you open your eye to something and ends when you close the eye again, or when you turn somewhere else, then you get different kinds of Hyle. Whenever your sense organs are affected, then you have Hyle. And it's not that we are thinking about the Hyle or aware of them. It's a kind of experience, and it's not, as many philosophers call it, there's no sense data. Many later and earlier people working on perception have said that there's sense data involved, that when you open your eyes, you receive sense data. And that immediately makes you think there must be something I see. a datum or something that is given to you, something you see. And for Husserl, the hyle are not things we see. It's not something out there. So it should not be mixed up with a feature of the object or anything like that. It's simply an experience that I undergo when my sensory organs are affected. And noesis is then also an activity that goes on that structures my anticipations of things in the world. And the things that I'm experiencing with the object that are structured in the way they are, thanks to the noesis, and which are constrained thanks to the hyle. That's why I can experience a duck or a rabbit, but not a locomotive in that particular situation. You may just come back, because these are very important things to get right. But now, what about the noema? Well, the noema is non-temporal. You can have the same noema at some later time. You cannot have the same hyle later on, because these are experiences and they go. I can have similar experiences later, but not the same experience. But the noema is something, it's a structure, and that structure you can have in a later act also. And thanks to that structure, there is something which now starts looking a little bit like sin in Frege, but that's only one small component here. It has to do with the fact that now I see a duck, and there are various features of the duck that are expressed through the scene, so that the meaning component of the act can be expressed by properties of the object out there, relations of that object there to other objects, and so on. So that that's very similar to meaning or Sinn in Frege. But there's more in the noema for Husserl. One really easy thing is the thetic component. You can have a noema of perceiving, let's say, a duck. So that is structuring going on in the perceiving of the duck. But when you think about the duck, then you can have the same structuring, so that you can think about the duck, which is just like the previous one that you actually saw. So the difference is that, of course, the noesis is different, because it has now a thetic element. So one thetic component here, thetic means that you are positioning, you are in a way asserting that there is something there. And that's what differs between imagining, perceiving, remembering. I can remember that duck, but remembering it is not the same as perceiving it. And you can imagine the duck, and you have various kinds of thetic features of an act. So an act of imagining is therefore different from an act of thinking, an act of perceiving, and so on. And the difference between them lies in the thetic component. So the thetic component is simply what differentiates different kinds of act, while the meaning component is what these acts in my example have in common. They are acts which seem to have directedness towards a duck. And now we get something very important when we compare and contrast Husserl to Frege. And this idea that we're now getting to is really an idea Husserl had, and which solves a lot of problems in semantics and philosophy of language, which you don't have in Frege at all. And that is that the meaning component, let us say we have an act of perception, you have a meaning component which has to do with the structuring of that act. But for Frege, as soon as you have an object satisfying the meaning, then that the object of the act. However, Husserl says that the meaning of the act should really be analyzed differently. And he says that at about the same time as Frege, so it's not criticism of Frege, but it's just an alternative way of looking at it. And when I have an act, let us say, one which whose tethic component is perception, but it fits correspondingly for other kinds of act. You have an act, you experience you as being confronted with an object. This is an act which has this kind of object. And you know from past experience that objects often have much more to them than what you are aware of. So that there is a kind of what Husserl calls in English, translated into English, determinable X. In German it's bestimmbares X. And I think all of you know English, but only a couple of you are German. So we call it determinable X. There is an X that remains to be determined. So that it's not that we have the act, have the object in its fullness, that we just have some features of it and we'll find more out more about it. And then from past experience we know that when we are directed towards an object like that, then we know that maybe the object is slightly different from what we thought. It's attributed to it certain properties, but we understand that it wasn't quite like that. And so the meaning component, the sin, may change a little bit as we go on and find out more about the object. Remember, the sin, the meaning component, has also to do with what the object was like earlier, what it will be like tomorrow, what it's like now. And sometimes we discover that we were a little wrong in our anticipation. We say it's the same object, that just was wrong. And so Husserl would analyze these different kinds of ways in which we can go wrong. And as long as the wrongness isn't making us see that there was no object at all, but it's just a little bit different. So we have the same object, but so there is the idea that there is a determinable X out there, and that we try to find out what that determinable X is like. And in that process, we may come to change our views on what the object is like. This is different from Frege, because for Frege the word has a sin meaning. And what the object is whatever satisfies that sin. If you discover that you have a wrong conception or something, and actually your sin satisfied by some other object that you never thought of or heard of, then for Frege that would be the object of the act. And you see, that sounds a little unnatural. So Husserl comes, I think, closer to our intuitions of what we are after, namely that we are after an object. That's the object that Brentano talked about. It's an object of the act, but we are aware that we may be mistaken, that we might have wrong views about the object, and gradually as we explore it, then we revise our views. And then there could be things that happen when we explore it that make us see that there was no such object at all. I hallucinated. Or the object that it was something totally different from what I had in mind. So that's why we can have acts without an object, and we can have acts with an object. So that takes care of Brentano's thing, that it always seems to us as if an act has an object, that we may discover that it had none. And looking back at Frege, we could have said that what Frege could have said is that when we are having a referring expression, we use it and it seems as if we refer to something, but sometimes we discover that there was no such thing. So that I think that combination of these three components here, that there's a petty component that differs from one kind of act to another, there's a meaning component which develops as we explore the act. So we have some vague notion of what the object is like in the beginning, and then we may come to change the meaning component, and sometimes we discover that what we encounter is a different, that was not the object we had in mind at all. So the notion of determinable X is a very good one, because it indicates that we are really exploring the world and finding out more about the world. And there are objects in the world, X, which are determinable. We try to find out more and more about it. And that shows also that we have to have, in order to come to this, we have to have a conception of how much leeway can we accept and still say it's the same object. That happens all the time, that we discover that we were a little bit wrong. and what kind of deviations will force us to say there was no such object at all. This is a slight leeway. And as long as we can adjust, then the moving component gets adjusted. And in some cases, our mistake is so serious that we say, I was totally wrong. Well, that's where I think we should take a break so that you have time to let this sink in, because this is maybe the most crucial little thing in the whole course of Husserl. Once you get that right, then so many other things in Husserl become quite natural. I'm going to talk about later in the class will be very easily understood. But one thing that I did not mention at all is that I put this double arrow here between noesis and noema. And that is because what you have on those two sides will be very strongly interconnected with one another. The noema could best be compared to a structure. And when I experience something, the object I'm experiencing is experienced as having that structure. We get to it when we got into philosophy of mathematics, for example. If there's a triangle out there, the noema would be the noema of a triangle, so that the triangularity is then an important part of that noema. And there could be more complicated structures in perception. Part of the structure is not just what the object is like, but also how it is located relative to me, and of course all the anticipations we have about the other side of the object. All of that is part of the noema. So the noema contains all that is in my mind, which has the structure that I attribute to the object. It doesn't mean that the noema has the final structure that might arrive to if I should have been able to explore the object fully. And Husserl actually says that the objects are so rich that you will never exhaust them completely. But the noema would have the structure that we attribute to the object. All of that structure is in the noema. And if I encounter that object later, I could again attribute the same structure to it, and I will have the same noema, or basically the same, because there will be some differences in that the time in which I see the object will be a different one the second time. So the relation between that particular structure of the object and other factors like time and so on could be different, so the noema will be a little bit different, but the key part of it would be the structure of the object. Yeah.
How is this different from concepts?
A concept. It is very similar to concepts, so that it's a broader notion, but it's the same kind of thing. A concept also would be something that you don't really like to attribute time to. A concept remains. You can have the same concept at two different times, and you can have the same noema at two different times, except that in the case of the noema, there would be this relation to its being your noema, and that it has to do with the object now and not tomorrow or yesterday. So that there are time indicators and things like that, and space indicators in the noema, which would make them differ a little bit from time to time. But the noema is, although it's tremendously rich, it contains a lot of components that we have never thought of, but that are there because they are sedimentations from past experience that we have never reflected on and so on. So it includes all these subconscious features. Still, there's a lot of features about the object that has no correspondence to in the noema. So the noema is not simply the total structure of the object as it could have been found out by somebody who knew everything. It's simply from our limited past experience what we anticipate. Yeah.
So is this Hegel component part of all acts, or just acts of sensing?
It's a part only of acts of sensing, where they play a role in confining your noema in a certain way. So that we have in a certain way healed another, our sensory experiences are involved, but very often, so whenever it's only, you know, they have these experiments where you're suspended weightlessly in a liquid and so on. We try to arrange something where you have absolutely no sensing going on, then there would be no healer. But as soon as senses are affected, there would be healer. But very often, when our senses are affected, our mind is occupied with other things. Now when I lecture, my senses are affected all the time. I'm awake, but I'm concentrated on my what I'm saying and on you, and therefore the structuring I perform is really not much related to. And when I do mathematics or focus on things that have nothing to do with what I perceive around me like that, then the healing will play a very constraining role. It does play, my first example of talking to you is a little bit misleading, because I do have healer, which here are constraining me a little bit. So that if I hear, see that you do this, for example, then I try to raise my voice and things like that, so that I do register certain things. But clearly, I think doing mathematics is a good example. Then you can sit there, close your eyes, and you just study the structures in mathematics. And there you have nuimata all the time, but there are no healer that perform any kind of constraining at all. So, yeah.
Is noema somehow similar to the Heidegger structure to understand something as something?
Yes, Heidegger has this to understand something as something, and that you find in Wittgenstein also. But you remember I said that it's a little misleading, because that first something should really be dropped. There is no object which is understood as something. Whatever the notion of object there is one that is a pneumatic object, a determinable X. And then very often it could be a determinable X, but it turns out not to be an object for the act, because you were simply so far off. But in normal, successful perception, you would have a regular object out there that you see and hear, and so on. But all perception could turn out to be fallacious, Husserl says. So there could be that you're sure that this is normal perception, but then something is, for example, the brain in the vat and so on, with the cases where the brain experiences normal perception, but where we who are outside and other information, we know that it is not. But in any case, think of the noema as this kind of very rich structure. And that's why the noema can come back in different acts, because it's the structure that is the same, although the act itself takes place at a different time. And the noesis of the act is structural, similar to the noema. It's the same structure, but here you talk about the occurrence, the temporal occurrence of that structure in your mind. So that most structures, of course, never come to your mind. But when you have an act with a certain noesis, then that act would have a corresponding noema. So that was that's the explanation for that double arrow. The fact that there's always this parallel between noema and noesis, that the noesis is the temporal instantiation of the structure. The noema is the repeatable structure that could be repeated again and again. Then there was another question concerning the thetic component here. The thetic component has exclusively to do with the kind of act you have. So that's what is different when you're perceiving, imagining, hallucinating, remembering. So that I can perceive an object. I can perceive you, for example, and I can turn away and I can remember you. And that means the thetic component is different, although the object that I'm experiencing is the same. And of course the healer would be different, since I'm turning away and so on. So the thetic component is relatively simple and straightforward. It simply is the kind of act you're dealing with. Is it perception, imagining, remembering, and so on? Is there anything else that you feel? I'm sure you will discover problems as you go on, but we can get back to them. Yeah?
So feelings, are they part of the aesthetic component or the hyle or?
Oh yeah, no, the feelings you have, you might find something pleasant. You can see you're presenting with a nice cake and you have some nice feelings about expecting to eat it. Those feelings are reflected in the noesis and in the noema. Once you taste it, you also get reflected in the hyle. But as far as this goes, you immediately structure what the object is as not only looking in a certain way, but having a certain kind of taste. Remember, the components that you find in your structuring in the noesis or the noema are very, very rich. I mentioned not only factual components, that it looks like so and so, but it tastes this way. You can think about your different senses. If you take it in your hand, it might be squashed, that little piece of cake, and things like that. And all of these features are reflected in the noema. And also the anticipation that once you have eaten it, it won't be on the table anymore. So that the noema and the corresponding the noesis really contain a tremendous richness of features. There may be more questions coming up, but at least this little diagram, I think, should help you to see the basic structure of pretty much everything in Husserl. Now, this is for those of you who are interested in philosophy of language and logic and things like that. In philosophy of language, there has been a lot of discussion concerning what was Hilary Putnam called the twin word example. That is, but Husserl actually had that same example 60 years earlier. So a good deal of contemporary philosophy of language has been constructed in order to deal with the twin word example. And this is how Husserl formulated it in a manuscript from 1911. It's just out now, but it has been in the archives for a long time. So how is it if on two celestial bodies, two people and surroundings that seem to be totally similar, conceive of the same object and adjust the utterances accordingly? Does not the this in these two cases have a different meaning? So that if the setting is the same, and you point to an object and say this, and somebody else in a very similar setting, all anticipations and so on are the same, also says this, do these two words, this, have the same meaning? And this Husserl is able to deal with by bringing in this determinable X, because the idea is that the properties that we assign to this object might be the same. Everything looks very similar. So from a property point of view, are the objects the same? Had you been Frege, you would say, well, it's the same sin, and therefore it must be the same object. But Husserl says, no, it might not be the same object. You have the idea of the determinable X, and the determinable X is your idea of there being an object there that I only partially have found out about. And these two people may, as they go on with their experience, find out that these are two different objects. They might, for example, discover that there is somebody over in the other celestial body who had similar experience, but it was obviously not the same object. It was just light years away. So that Husserl, and he gives three different versions of the example. And I don't want to go through all these examples. This would take time. I just mention it in order to show how the little arrow that we went through, and especially this notion of the determinable X, enables Husserl to deal with problems where traditional semantics, starting with Frege, is not able to deal with them because it doesn't make the proper distinctions. So that's this is something that isn't very well known because people haven't been aware of this manuscript, but I have had two students who have been working on it and written on it, and one of them is in America, David Smith. He has also written a big book on Husserl, which I think is very good, and the other one is Professor in Göttingen. His name is Christian Beyer, and he has also then discussed this example here. so that you can find more discussions of it in these two people's writings. And now we get on to this idea of abstract objects and intuition. So now we are, you know, with the noema-noesis, one important difference is that the noesis was this concrete experience going on, and the noema was the structure. And now Husserl says that whenever we are confronted with an object, we could experience that as this particular physical object, or we could experience some general feature that that object has. So I'll give you some examples. Look here. If you look at these four figures on the canvas, then you see that this is one object, that's another, here is a third, there's a fourth. But they do have something in common, they are triangular. And you could focus on the triangularity and say that, well, same if you think of triangularity, a shape, as an object, because the object that you experience need not be physical object. You can experience an abstract entity. A lot of the things we deal with in our daily lives are abstract entities that can be instantiated again and again. So here we have triangularity instantiated here, and here, and here, and here. This is not such a perfect triangle, but it's close enough. So we ask, what is the shape for that tree? It's triangular, or you might say it's conic. But and now here you have one problem here is what kind of general features are there in the world. In the previous case it was easy, triangularity was striking. Here you have three objects, and if I ask you, do you see similarities between them? Then you might say, well, I think the cup and the glass are similar, because remember, for Husserl, the practical features are important, and they're both practically applicable for drinking. So that, you know, a donut isn't really good for drinking, but these two are good for drinking. You might say that these two are a little bit similar, they are rather roundish, here you have the handle protruding. Depending on what features you focus on, you will say they are similar in that and that way. And this is a good illustration of seeing how many different kinds of features you can find and similarities you can find. So you can find similarities between these two. You can find similarities between these two. And do anybody see similarities between these two?
Yeah. One hole.
One hole. Yeah, that's you must have been studying some topology, mathematics. It's right. It's a one hole. This you could say it's a hole because it's deep. But if you make them of Play-Doh, you know, the kind of, you all know what Play-Doh is, then you can shape this into that by continuous movement. You don't have to tear things apart, you don't have to stick things together, but that hole in the handle is important because that gives you the hole in the middle. All the rest here you can get together without pasting things or cutting things. And how do you do it? Now I'll show you. Look at that cup now. You see? So you can't get the glass to go that way. Oh, it's back to the cup. So that shows you that there are many different features that can be similar between different objects. And now we'll go on to something else. This is in illustrating the richness of perception, because when you perceive a cube, you structure it in such a way that your anticipation of what it will look like, if you move around it or if it moves relative to you, these anticipations are really built into our from past experience. And it's rather complicated if you try to describe these lines and points mathematically. You get equations that you certainly have not learned how to solve. Those who are doing mathematics would have learned it. But if you have never done mathematics, how can it be that you can see that that's clearly a rotating cube? And you could, if you just change the things a little bit, you can say, no, that's not a rotating cube. The things that don't fit in with your anticipations. So how can it be that you have all these other complicated anticipations of what the cube will look like from all these different points of view without being able to carry out the calculations? And you haven't seen a cube from all these angles before. And still, you see that it's a cube that is moving, and also that it will seem differently if there were features of the cube. Like, you can have something that looks like a cube from one side, but not from the other. But you can see that this is a real proper cube because of the aspects that it displays at different occasions. So this shows how rich our sets of anticipations is. So that Husserl says that our anticipations are based on past experience. And we do get a lot in seeping into past experience. We don't have to make judgments each time we learn something. We learn much, most of what we learn is learned without our even knowing that we learn it. And this is the kind of things that you have learned without knowing it. And so this illustrates both structures, moving structures. That is, here we have a structure, a cube, and you anticipate what that structure will look like from many different angles. And in the case of everything in our daily experience, we have that tremendous amount of anticipations that we have never thought of. And Husserl's view is that we do basically learn it through experience. But how can we learn such a complicated structure as that through experience when we have only experienced sometimes some cube from one side, from other? But I think it's the first time for many of you that you have experienced a rotating cube. So this then leads us on to Husserl's idea that we can experience structures and not just full concrete objects. So, for example, are these two knots the same? This is again topology, a branch of mathematics where you're studying this kind of structures. And the problem is, can these knots here be turned into one another? Can you untie this knot and get this, or do you have to cut it sideways? This is called knot topology, a topology of knots. Not with a K. And here is the theory of knots. This was developed by a person named Kurt Reidemeister, and I'm interested in him because I studied with him in Göttingen. And this is what he invented. This is one of his contributions to mathematics. He said that if you have two knots, you could have lost your fishing string. Or you could be knitting and lose your yarn. In all cases, you can get very complicated knots, like the ones we saw. That left one isn't so fairly complicated, but you can have very much more complicated ones. But however complicated it is, you can decide whether two knots have the same structure through three kinds of movement. You can twist if you can get from one to another by either making such a thing, or by pushing the one above the other, or by moving from this side to that side. Three simple movements. And Reidemeister proved that any two knots that over at all can be turned into one another, can be turned into another by a repetition of these three moves. So that's an interesting thing. And topology has been further developed. It's become one of the important fields of mathematics. And all kinds of things that have to do with structure that you study in topology. So when I use the word structure so often, with Husserl trying to use it to explain noema, noesis, and all that, it is this notion of structure. You have sameness of structure in many cases. And Husserl uses the word eidos for this structure. The structure itself he calls eidos. And certain eidoses are found in consciousness, noumeta. But what eidos is that you don't find in consciousness. For example, eidos is in very complicated nests of strings and so on, knots. And but one kind of eidos, that was a question that I got earlier about concepts, are they like the noumenta? And I said that they are similar, they are both structures, but you could have concepts that nobody had ever thought of. You know, you think about the concepts as kind of set of structures that sometimes people fit into words, other times they're not put into words. But here are some examples of concepts, and this I try to use some examples from the philosophy of mathematics, since so many of you are taking Øystein's course. And one notion that is used in mathematics is continuity. You say that a function is continuous. That means basically if you draw a diagram of it, you can draw the diagram without lifting the pen from your paper. It's just continuous. And one question about continuous functions would be if you draw them, a curve would normally have a tangent, just explaining how steep it goes up or down. And you know that there are some cases where a curve doesn't have any tangent, of course. It ends in just on that point. You don't really know should the tangent go this way, that way, or it's not determined what the angle of the tangent would be there. So you have this kind of corner, so, where depending on which way you approach the corner, you can't really get a fully determined tangent in that corner. And one open question in the philosophy, in the history of mathematics was, could there be, most continuous functions have a tangent that can be there's a differential of it in each point. But there are curves that have corners like this, where they have no tangent in that point. And it was generally assumed that if you have a continuous function that you draw without lifting the pen, then at least it would have a tangent in most points. There could be some exceptional points where you have corners, but could you have a curve that is just corners? And that was finally proved by Bolzano about 1830. And 60 years later, Husserl's teacher, Weierstrass, proved the same thing. At that time, of course, Bolzano had life in prison. So he wasn't publishing anything, but we just have his notes, and he did all these things without people knowing about it. But they discovered around 1920, when they went through all these notes, that he had a lot of important mathematical results that he had gotten. And one of them is anticipating this thing by Weierstrass. And there shows, it constructs a curve which is continuous but nowhere differentiable. There's not a single point on the curve that is differentiable. It's just so zigzaggy that there's no place without these zigzags. And that curve is now what we call the chaotic curves. They are the ones that are used in chaotic behavior and so on, like when we predict climate change and weather and things like that, then we get into this. And Bolzano constructed the first some chaos curve. And then Weierstrass did it later. But of course, when you should show that it's something is possible, then you normally do it by giving an example. And Bolzano's example of such a function is simpler than Weierstrass. What is so clear and good about Bolzano, which really made him so remarkable, is that his mind was so clear that he saw exactly what is needed. And he gave an example which contains just what you need, nothing superfluous. Weierstrass' example has some superfluous things in it, so it's not as simple as Bolzano's. But both of these people who were very important for Husserl, Bolzano, who died 11 years before Husserl was born, so he never met, but he studied his writing and was very impressed. And Weierstrass, who was his teacher, both of them made important contribution to this kind of field. Now, I said that continuity means that the curve can be drawn in one stroke, but we'll also hear later about the continuum hypothesis, and that was important result was reached by Gödel, And we'll get back to that because the last meeting will take up more specific problems in the philosophy of mathematics. But I just want to mention to you that the talk about continuity in connection with Balsam and Feierstrass is not what Gödel had meant with the continuum hypothesis. And here I mention also that Gödel was very interested in computability. And I know some of you are from computer science, so you heard about this. And this film that won at least one Oscar, this one is von Turing, who found out how to define clearly computability, and Gödel was very, that was a very good contribution, the one that Turing made. But we'll get back to this later. This is just, but now we get to something which is important in Husserl generally, and it connects with Kant and many others. And that is that so far we talked about perception, where the object of the act is a physical thing. And I gave examples, the duck rabbit, the cup, the tourist, and so on. Of all these examples that we talked about are having to do with perception, sense experience. However, Husserl distinguishes two kinds of experience of the world. And the other one is one where the object of the act is not a physical thing, but it is what he calls an essence, or an eidos in German, Wesen. And one such essence could be, for example, one-holedness. That was what united the cup and the donut, was one-hold. So that's an essence, that's a general feature, a structural feature. So there, when we talked about the cup and the donut, we actually focused on structural features and not on the physical object. So we have already been sneaking in as objects of our acts, not just the physical object, but also shapes and things like that of the physical object. And those features, Husserl calls them essential features or essence of the object, or often eidos, these are words he uses in different ways. So the triangularity, and we show these triangles that are manifested in different contexts. These are, the triangularity itself is an object of our act, but the act in that case has as an object a structure. We say that's the same structure as this one. And it doesn't matter what the material manifestation of the structure is, we can focus on the structure rather than on that particular physical object. And that's the case, Husserl says, that we think about perception as being so basic, and it focuses on perceiving physical things. But we should be aware that a lot of our experience of the world around us is not focusing on the particular physical thing, but it's focusing on features, general features, that thing could share with many other features, like triangularity and so on. So that all these features that can be shared by many objects, Husserl calls essential features or eidos. And let us especially remember the word eidos. That's a rare word, but again Husserl uses that to distinguish now two different kinds of what he call reduction. But both these perception and essential insight are instances of what Husserl calls intuition. And intuition is then a kind of act where you are actually experiencing an object, whether it be a physical object or an essence or an eidos. So that intuition doesn't mean that, well, I have a vague intuition or such and such. It means a kind of experiencing. And this is the basic kind of relation we can bear to the world with its concrete and abstract objects. So here already you see that Husserl places the abstract object triangularity and so on the level of physical objects. So the world around us has both physical objects and abstract entities in it. So therefore, when we are people are trying to calculate the largest prime number, for example, they were wondering, is there such a thing as the largest prime number? And then mathematicians talk about what they are doing. They talk about trying to discover certain things. They don't talk about it as invention. So whether there's a larger prime number, so it's really a discovery and not a matter of invention. And that's reflected in patent law. If you are, two of you are working with computer science, if you develop a good algorithm or a good program, you can patent it. And many of the very rich people have gotten rich through that, that they patented something that was very useful. But if you're a mathematician and prove a new theorem, like Weierstrass or Bolzano, and go to the patent office, they say, oh no, you can't patent, this is a discovery. Likewise, if you are sailing and discover an island that nobody knew about, you want to patent it. No, no, you can't patent it, you just discovered an island. So this is talking in the Husserlian way. These are entities that you discover and not the entities that you invent. So this already gives a kind of Platonistic feature of Husserl. Like Plato, he thinks that there are these entities, not just physical objects, but also idols. So that it's not simply that he's a naive realist, like say, well, there are physical objects, there are numbers, all kinds of abstract entities, and we just find out what they're like. They're all objects that we discover by this kind of exploration. And the way in which we discover them, we see that there is a kind of connectedness with our mind in these objects, so that this view that he is opposed to is often called naive realism, because you say, well, there are physical objects, there are these abstract entities, and that's all we can say about it. It's naive. It doesn't really ask any more questions. But what Husserl says is that there are physical objects, there are mathematical entities and so on, but in order to understand them, what they are and so on, we have to look into the functioning of our mind, and we see how there's a structure that we impose upon the world, but that structure is not simply coming from us, but it's coming from our living in this world. So we learn through, by living in the world, what that world is like. And then, once we then extrapolate, once we start experience the world on the basis of our past experience, then we come to treat these entities as if they are there to be discovered. And this comes even nicer out in some of Gödel's things that we are going to get to, because Gödel was so impressed by Husserl. And Gödel had ideas about the foundations of mathematics that he tries to work out in manuscripts and so on. He never published them, but he did work hard on these issues. And then when he discovered Husserl, he thought that Husserl has really seen things in the right way. And then he saw how all his glimpses fits very well into that Husserlian framework. And from then on, 1969, when he discovered Husserl, he became a phenomenologist. But we'll get to it gradually. But in any case, it's a good question, because it's a little bit like Platonism. Mm-hmm. And it's a little bit like Husserl when he said in 1936 that nobody could be more of a realist than I am. Then he went away from his old use of idealism and saw that his position is different from traditional idealism. And you could say he goes away a little bit from naive Platonism, but he ends up with a view that has many similarities in that you are exploring this world. You are not inventing it. But I think this might become clearer in this last lecture, because I know that some of you know this very well and others not. And I want at least now to stick to the things that should be comprehensible to everybody. And now we get to the ego. So Husserl talks about the ego. And the idea is that the ego is, the point we'll see is that it is embodied. The ego is not just fleeting out there in the universe, but it's embodied. It has a body. And it is social. And these are two very important features of Husserl that are very important for the interest in phenomenology, that he talks about the embodiment and the social nature, our ability for empathy, Einfühlung, things like that. So that's what we're now going to look at. and then we'll talk then about Husserl and the self, because so far we have really always focused on the arrow end of the act. I haven't really said anything about what was at this left end, and I hope you got a good idea of what the act is like and what object we have on the arrow end. But for Husserl there is also a subject act of the act, and there he distinguishes two aspects of the ego. The notion of aspect is very important, helpful for understanding Husserl, that everything has many different aspects. The things out there in the world that we experience, they can be experienced from many different perspectives. The morning star, evening star example that Frege used, and by the way, Husserl uses the same examples, taking it from Frege. That example shows how this star can be experienced from one point of view or from another point of view. And now, if you turn to the origin of the act, the ego can similarly be experienced from different points of view. And one way of experiencing our own ego is by observing it from the outside. Others observe us from the outside, you could say. And if I look at myself in my mirror, in the mirror, I see myself and I can perceive myself. And that's very similar to just perception of other objects. So that is grasping one aspect of myself, namely my empirical ego. So Husserl talks also about the transcendental ego. That is the ego that is the originator of acts. That's not one that you just study by looking, but you have this Husserlian way of explaining the structures, so that we have looked so far at the activities of what Husserl then calls the transcendental ego, because that is an ego that plays a very important role in our grasping the world and the world being the way it is. And these are the two aspects of the ego that Husserl distinguishes. You remember Descartes had what we call a dualist view. He has the, what Husserl calls the empirical ego, we have the body, and then we have the soul. And the problem for Descartes is how can the two be one? And the other view is monist. Husserl has a monist view, but he thinks that, like everything else, that ego has different aspects. We can experience as a physical object, or we can experience as an originator of acts. So there's nothing mysterious here. It's just one and the same object seen from different perspectives. And for Descartes was it quite a problem. How can the empirical ego and the body and the mind interact? Of course, there could be no interaction here. So he said that, well, there's this special little thing in the brain, the Kongelige Kjertel in Norwegian. They can affect one another. And one knows now that the hypothalamus that he had in mind, they had discovered that it was very important. But that's what he thought. Things happen. But in any case, people didn't think too highly of that, and they proposed other views. One was Malebranche, follower of Descartes. He said that, well, you don't have to think about there being some point in the brain where the mind and the body interact. God takes care of that. You know, when I think that I want to lift my arm, then God sees to it that it goes up. So that and you know, when something affects my eye, then God sees to it that I now have the experience of seeing something out there. So that was one way of looking at it. And Leibniz, he said, why should God be kept so busy? Every time somebody wants to lift the arm, God has to take care of it. And there are so many people around, so he would really be quite busy. No, God, the Almighty, he created the world in perfect harmony. So that he foresaw that when somebody wants to lift the arm, then the arm goes up. So that you didn't have God there as a kind of servant to take care of all these correlations. But in any case, Husserl doesn't think of it like he's a monist, and there's the empirical ego and the transcendental ego. And one thing that I haven't mentioned before, which is important here, is that you have to watch out very carefully when you read Husserl, because he sometimes talks about transcendent and other times about transcendental, and these are two quite different notions. What is transcendent? This isn't right. That is everything that has a kind of inexhaustibility of further features. So physical objects are transcendent. There is much more to them than what meets the eye. And similarly, the ego is transcendent. There is much more to me than I can ever find out. So you can't have complete knowledge even of yourself. And it's a little bit, you know, Freud and Husserl were both influenced by Brentano, and they both had the idea that there's so much in us that we can never really get it at it all. So transcendence simply means that it goes beyond what we can at any time know. We can know more and more. There's nothing that in principle is inaccessible, but whatever we find out, there will always be much, much more that could have been found out. And but the ego is transcendental. And that means that it is something that is not empirical. So that it's something that we then have to explore through what Husserl calls the transcendental reduction that we're coming to. But in any case, it's hard maybe to keep these two words apart when you read Husserl. Both of them are a little bit uncommon words. And I noticed that in translation, for Sartre wrote an early essay on this distinction in Husserl. But the translators of Sartre tend to be people from literature who don't know the distinctions. And they go back and forth translating transcendent as transcendental or transcendental as transcendent, depending on what sounds best. And that, of course, makes it very hard to understand what is going on when you read Sartre. But when you read from come from Husserl, Husserl is very careful and clear, and then you get this distinction. And so there is one self, and it has these two aspects. And now I go quickly through this, that there are the acts that you carry out, and these could be all kinds of acts. One thing I haven't mentioned is that the acts that you carry out could also be speech acts. Of course, we talked about perception a lot, but when we speak, we are carrying out acts. Later on, for example, Austin has been very famous for his work on speech acts, and he points out, for example, that when you give a promise, then it's not just the words you say, but the setting in which you say it. So that if you say to somebody, I promise you 100 crowns tomorrow, and you don't give it to him, then you could say, well, I was lying. But Austin would say, no, your promise is a promise, whatever you thought when you gave it. So that it's a setting. The way in which you utter those words make it a promise. So this kind of distinction Husserl was very aware long, long before. And there were a couple of Husserl students who really developed speech act theory in the 1930s, long before it came with Austin and others. But it's the same basic idea, and Austin got it from himself, not from Husserl. But in any case, speech acts are one version of acts, which Husserl discusses quite a lot. And then we can have, when we look at the self now, I can have propensities, I can have beliefs and desires and skills, bodily skills and mental skills. All of these are features of myself, propensities I have. So when I look about the self, I first have the acts that I carry out just now, and then I have something that lasts longer, namely a propensity to carry out that kind of act. Next time I see a person, I know the person beforehand, and I can meet the same person, and there's an association created by the previous act and this act and so on. So these are things that remain longer than the act itself, and it's there as a feature of the ego. And that also holds for desires, for skills and so on that are important for Husserl's view of communication. And then we can have a kind of second order thing, and that is a propensity to have first order propensities. A propensity, for example, you say something, the first order propensity would be that you actually believe it and keep on believing it. A second order propensity could be that you are a little bit gullible. You tend to form beliefs that you ought not to form on your evidence, or you might have other kinds of propensities that affect how your first order beliefs are established. So this is a kind of propensity to establish various kinds of first order beliefs, and the beliefs you have are of course propensities to say something rather than other things and so on. And then at the top level you have the full person, who then has all these kinds of dispositions, both dispositions to act in certain ways, propensities that are dispositions that also are there when we don't act at present, and then secondary propensities, this kind of personality features, like gullibility or kindness or something. So if you have this, so these are what Husserl calls personality features. What you happen to believe just now is not so central to your personality as how you form your beliefs. So some people might want some evidence before they form their beliefs, others might think that's not needed. And also kindness and other features that are relevant in ethics, for example, will be here. And then the person would then be the object, the entity that has all these features. So this is then something about these two aspects. So that sums up a little bit what we have been talking about. So what we'll now do, now we talked a little bit about the transcendental ego, so we have completed what was listed for March the 9th, and next time in a week then we'll look much more at the subject and intersubjectivity and objectivity and empathy and ethics and so on, how they flow out of this framework.